So also the lecture of yesterday, I realize some of you did not, you had other engagements. It will be on the internet. I should say it should be on the internet this afternoon. I was told that this, yes?
It was on like
9 o'clock.
I'm sorry? Said it was on like 9 o'clock.
Oh, good, good. Thank you. So that's good. Well, at least those of you who had a chance to log on to it, you could see it. So that the lecture of yesterday afternoon is on the internet. And we will have a class every Thursday for the rest of the semester, except during the Thanksgiving week. So that will basically make up the 6 classes we missed, or I missed. Okay, so now I think it's 11:15, so we can start. So that's where we were on Wednesday, and I'm just going to go quickly in like first 5 minutes what we talked about last night or last evening. So we had introduced the contact force Fi. Cauchy's postulate says Fi is a function, or it depends upon the orientation of the surface only through the outward normal. And then the balance of linear momentum, or the conservation of linear momentum, showed that it should be a linear function of n, and therefore we should be able to write it in this form, and the quantity in the box we called Cauchy stress tensor. So that is the present force divided by the present area. It is also sometimes called true stress. There is no such thing as artificial stress or false stress. Even though we have true stress, but we don't have false stress. Generally, now, loosely speaking, this, the true stress is present force divided by the present area. But if you divide the present force by the area in the undeformed state or the reference state, you get engineering or nominal stress. Okay, you do not get false stress. And then this Tij, it has 9 components because I and J both go from 1 to 3. And these 9 components, we show it on a plane along 3 different planes. This one gives the outward unit normal to the plane, and Fi gives the direction. So the way we are doing it, the second index on the Cauchy stress tensor T, the second index, the index on the right side. So this is the first index, that is the second one. The second one gives us the direction of the normal to the plane, and the first one gives us the direction of the force on that plane. So each plane has 3 forces, one in the x1 direction, one in the x2, and one in the x3. If the force is in the direction of the outward normal, so that's that is normal stress, and if the force is perpendicular to the outward normal, so that's tangential stress or shear stress. Okay, so Ti1 will be the 3 components of stresses acting on the plane whose outward normal is E1 or X1 plane. Ti2 are tractions or stresses acting on the plane whose outward normal is X2, and similarly for Ti3. And then we simplified by using the divergence theorem, and we will do that part again for the balance of linear momentum. And basically we use the divergence theorem on this part to get to the volume integral rather than the surface integral, and we ended up with the Cauchy's Cauchy's law of motion, or we also call it, now this thing is conservation of linear momentum, balance of linear momentum, or the equation of motion, whichever you like. All 3 are same thing. So this equation will be used over and over and over for the rest of your life if you work in continuum again, if you work in stress analysis or vibration analysis. Analysis of any continuous structure whether it's fluid or solid or gas, if you are studying the deformations of a continuous body, whether they are time dependent or time independent, whether it is soft tissue, whether steel, copper, aluminum, titanium, carbon, boron, polymers, no matter which material, like your hair or my hair, our skin, soft tissue, bone, everything must obey, their deformations must obey this equation. There is no way out. Okay? Like Newton's second law of motion must hold for a rigid body, this equation must hold for a continuous body. The only difference is, of course, I said so many materials. Now you might be wondering, am I crazy? No, I'm not crazy. This is true. The difference between materials will come how the stress tensor Tij depends upon the deformation. That part we have not covered yet. So we have not defined what is steel, what is copper, what is aluminum yet. However, this equation in the box must hold. If you are studying equilibrium problems, which means there is no deformation is not depending upon time, or it depends upon time very slowly, then acceleration is zero. Remember, if the body is deforming, there is something changing with the time. Otherwise, it cannot be deforming. So the only question is whether you want to consider inertia force or not. So if you want to consider the inertia force, and in many problems you must, like if there is an explosion, or there is an earthquake, or there is wind, hurricane, waves, you must consider acceleration. And if you must consider acceleration, then AI, that's the acceleration, is not zero. So we must satisfy this equation. Now typically in solid mechanics, we take the body force to be zero. So this BI, that's the body force per unit mass, in a solid mechanics problem, we typically take it to be zero, because the stresses induced or the deformations caused by the gravity or the body force is very small. Deformations induced by the body force or gravity field are very small, so we neglect them. It doesn't mean they are not there. They are there, but they are very small as compared to the deformations induced by the externally applied loads. And those have not come into picture yet. They will soon. In fluid mechanics, we consider the effect of gravity. I mean, if you may or may not have heard, this new building near McBride Hall, it could not be opened on time because the engineers or persons who built it, they did not lay down the sewer pipe correctly. Because the sewer pipe they laid down is horizontal and it should have been inclined so that the gravity helps the flow of fluid. Okay. Now that building, they have to tear down the floor. They have to break down the concrete floor, take out the pipe and replace it before the building can be occupied. So gravity in fluid mechanics is critical. Okay. Gravity, I mean, our shuttle also comes down because of gravity. Of course, we supply power to it too, for it to come down. But gravity does play a significant role in our lives. We cannot neglect it all the time. However, in solid mechanics problems, if you are designing a pressure vessel, or if you are designing a gas tank that is sitting outside your house, not necessarily in Blacksburg, but if you go to northern England, like New Hampshire or Vermont, most people have a oil tank outside the house. That you can design if you neglect gravity. There is no problem. Okay? I mean, you can design your car more or less without considering the effect of gravity. But you cannot design fluid flow, or you should not study fluid flow without considering gravity. Okay. Also, this AI, the acceleration in terms of velocity, is given by this expression, because acceleration is rate of change of velocity of a material particle, and therefore this is the total time derivative or substantial time derivative. And in terms of velocity, then we have two parts, local part of acceleration and the convective part of acceleration. And this term, which is nonlinear in velocity, makes the life interesting. That's one reason fluid mechanics problems are harder to solve than comparable solid mechanics problems. Because in solid mechanics, the acceleration part is linear in velocity because we work in the reference configuration. So we have to rewrite the balance law for a solid mechanics problem. We have to rewrite this equation in terms of big X and time for a solid mechanics problem. So we will do that. Okay, now let's go to the balance of moment of momentum then. Because as Josh pointed out last night, Cauchy's stress tensor is symmetric. Now we need to prove that it is indeed symmetric. So what we are going to do is we are going to write the balance of moment of linear momentum. So I use the word balance. Some authors use the word conservation. When I use the word balance of mass, balance of linear momentum, and balance of moment of momentum, some authors use conservation of mass, conservation of linear momentum, and conservation of moment of momentum. It's the same thing. Balance and conservation are equivalent. So depending upon whose book you are reading, you might see the word conservation or you might see the word balance. So it's now balance of moment of linear momentum . So we are in the present shape. So this is present configuration. And we look at a small piece. This is an arbitrary part P. So its linear momentum is mass density times the volume element. If you multiply by velocity VI, you get the linear momentum in the I direction. If you multiply with V1, you will get linear momentum in the X1 direction. We want to take its moment now. And KT told us last night to take moment, you take R cross F. So R cross F, and she also told us to find R cross F, you need permutation symbol. So that's what we are going to do. So the linear, its moment will be then d over dt of epsilon ijk rho dv vk. So that's part P. So that's the rate of change of linear momentum of the material enclosed in this shaded area, which is shown in red color. Okay? Now balance means the rate of change of linear momentum, the rate of change of moment of linear momentum should equal the moment of body force and the moment of contact forces. Okay, so the moment of body force will be epsilon ijk rho. Critical term, xj. Because the moment arm was not there, so how can we take a moment? So same thing here, the moment arm has to be there, xj. So that's rho bk dv. The moment arm is x. So the moment is r, which is the position vector, times the force. And its ith component is epsilon ijk xj fk. Moment is R cross F, where R is the position vector of any point on the line of action of the force F from the origin or from the point about which you are taking the moments. I mean, you are not happy.
Could you just repeat what each of these terms is?
Which one? This one?
Yeah.
This one is the, if you forget about d over dt, so that's the moment of linear momentum. And d over dt means rate of change of linear momentum. X, this is the moment arm, and this quantity is the linear momentum. And on this side now, so that's the moment of body forces plus moment of contact force. So that's on the boundaries. So again, epsilon I J K X J F K D A. So the force is F K D A. And the moment arm is X. And if you take the cross product, you need that permutation symbol. Okay. Does it make sense or not? And we proved earlier that d over dt of rho phi I dv equals rho phi I dot dv. Superimposed dot is the same thing as total time derivative. Phi I dot is the same thing as d phi I over dt. This we showed, I think, on Monday. So it should be in your notes of Monday. Except we did not put I on phi. We just said rho. We had a scalar rather than a phi there. So if we use that, then the first term, so that's this term. And I hope I can keep it. Okay. So this first term will become so now phi is the product of X and V. I did not put epsilon in it because the derivative of epsilon is zero. Epsilon is either 1 or minus 1 or 0. So it's a constant. And I could have put epsilon inside the print d over dt. But its derivative is 0. Its time derivative is 0. So its derivative with respect to anything is 0 because it's either 1 or minus 1 or 0. Okay, so if we now use the chain rule, what is the time derivative of xj? What is the total time derivative of xj? X is the present position. So rate of change of present position gives us what? Velocity. The rate of change of present position gives velocity. So that will be Vj, Vk. Vk, I just copied that. Plus xj, what is the rate of change of velocity? Acceleration. So very good. So that's ak, rho dv. Pierce already knows the answer to the next step. Because he is, if I'm reading his mind correctly, I'm not an astrologer, but if I'm reading his mind correctly, so he's going to tell us what is the next, what is this term? Epsilon ijk, vj vk. This was in your homework assignment number 2, problem number 2. 0, very good. Okay. This was, pardon? You are taking the cross product of this, of the vector with itself. You are taking the cross product of the vector with itself. So it is 0. Okay? So I can set it to 0. So we get rho. So we have epsilon ijk xj ak rho dv. Because epsilon ijk vj vk is 0. Another way of saying the same thing would have been vj vk is symmetric in j and k, and epsilon ijk is skew symmetric in j and k. If you interchange j and k, you change the sign. If you interchange j and k on epsilon ijk, you change the sign. But if you interchange j and k here, nothing happens. Vj, vk, same thing as vk, vj. So the homework problem you had was that if tij is skew symmetric, then tij, ai, aj equal to 0. Okay, now let's look at the other term. We are not done yet. So we have this term. This last one, and then we will combine all three of them. So if we look at just the last one, so that's this term. So if we look at this, the second term on the right hand side, so this term equals epsilon I j k x j. Now f k is t k l m l. That's how we defined t, the Cauchy stress tensor. That's how we said, like Fi Xej, or we said, like Fi is Tij and J. Fi, this Fi is Tij and J. So that's what I'm doing here. I'm setting Fk, because I have Fk, I'm setting Tkl and L. So this Fk is Tkl and L. I have a purpose, of course. So now we see this L and L. So what does it indicate? Inner product. So if you think of this whole thing as a vector, it really has two components. It has like A, I L, because J is summed, K is summed, so there are really two indices left, two free indices left on it. So I and L. But L and L are summed. which means we have something like A dot N. So if you forget about the first index for the time being, then we have dot product, which means we can use the divergence theorem. And I think that's what Josh said last night, that we can use the divergence theorem. The divergence theorem will transform this area integral to volume integration. And that's what we need, because other terms have volume integration in them. So if I use the divergence theorem, and remember in the that was a homework problem in homework set one, there was a problem use the divergence theorem. So that there was a purpose behind it, because we are going to use it. We used it last night also. So if we use the divergence theorem, then this becomes integration over the volume of over the volume of everything we have there. See, what we are really proving is what you proved in the mechanics of deforms class by taking a cube, that the stress tensor is symmetric. So like you proved sigma xy equal to sigma yx. That's what we are going to prove here, except we are proving all three of them in one shot. There you took moments about x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis, and you drew a cube. Here we are not drawing a cube, but the end result is same. Okay, does this stem make sense? Then we use the chain rule of calculus. Again, the derivative of epsilon, ijk with respect to x is 0. So I can just write it outside. So now I have to take derivative of xj with respect to xl. What is the derivative of xj with respect to xl? Delta jl. So that's delta jl. EKL plus XJ derivative of TKL with respect to XL. Islam is not happy. Is it okay? Chain rule. So you first differentiate epsilon, but you get zero. That term is gone. So we write epsilon outside. Then you differentiate x, j with respect to xl. You get delta jl. And of course, I have to copy tkl then. And then you differentiate tkl with respect to xl. And don't do anything with xj. Okay, now, so this l and l is summed. So what does that mean? How can I simplify it? Xiao, XIAO. So that will become TKJ. Right? So now let's combine all three terms. So what we have done is, on the left-hand side, we had epsilon ijk xj rho ak dv. On the right-hand side, first term is epsilon ijk xj rho bk dv p, plus the second term becomes p epsilon ijk TKJ plus XJ delta TKL over delta XL dV. So what I'm doing is I'm going back to this equation where we have written the balance of moment of momentum and substituting for the left-hand side and substituting for this term. We did not do anything with the body force term. So if we combine them, then this is what we get. Now we are going to transfer terms to one side. Whether right or left is your choice. So transfer the terms to one side. And if you notice, these three terms have xj in them. The one I have underlined with the green color have xj in them. So if I transfer this term to the right-hand side, so what we get then is, I don't know if green color is visible or not. Is it okay? No, it's not. So it's a 0 equal to then epsilon I j k x j, that's a common factor, minus rho a k plus rho b k plus delta t k l over delta x l dv plus epsilon I j k t k j dv. Okay, now, Mr. Chip, QIM, what is this term equal to? Chin, QIN, I think he's in the class. Yeah, what is this term equal to? Why? Your answer is correct, so don't worry. Yeah, we did that before. We did last night. Okay, this is the balance of linear momentum. This equation, as I preached in the first 5 minutes of the class, I gave a choir. This equation must hold. Remember, this is Bible. If you believe in Christianism, you believe in Bible, this equation is our Bible. Okay? I mean, this is, no matter which, like you believe in Islam or Hinduism or Christianism or whatever, this equation must hold. We cannot live without this equation. So this is, you can say, I don't know, whatever you wish to say, okay? You cannot forget this equation if you are in mechanics. So if this equation holds, then this term is zero. And as I said, this equation must hold. So I have already bored Josh. So this is zero. So what are we left with? We are left with one thing. Zero equal to that term. Okay? And we said last night also that since this equation has to hold for every part P, this equation, like 0 equal to this one, for every part P. Every part, that's the key word, every. For every part. The choice of part P is arbitrary. You can take P as small as you like, as big as you like. It can be located anywhere in the body. Therefore, the integrand must be zero. The integrand must be zero. Again, you did this homework problem. So I keep on hammering the homework problems. When I realize you do it and then throw it away, but remember, you are not supposed to throw it away. You are supposed to know what you have done in the homeworks. So what is the end? What can we say about TKJ then from this equation? Symmetric. So T, what this equation implies, that TKJ equals TJK. So this is the other law, Cauchy's other law of motion. So the first one is that this term must be zero, and the second one is T must be symmetric. So what we don't tell you in the mechanics of deformed class is that for the stress tensor to be symmetric, for the Cauchy stress tensor to be symmetric, not every stress tensor. I will talk about soon a stress tensor that is not symmetric. So do not think that every stress tensor is symmetric. Okay. So the Cauchy stress tensor, which is present force divided by the present area, or true stress tensor. Now this is symmetric only if, which we don't tell you in the mechanics of deformed classes, the balance of linear momentum holds. If this equation is satisfied. If this equation is not satisfied, we cannot conclude this result. Yes?
Is there actually a situation where that equation isn't going to hold in reality? Or if it doesn't hold, does that mean that there's something wrong with your experiment or something?
It's a good point. Now, there maybe it depends upon what you wish to study. If you are studying steel, copper, aluminum, nickel, polymers, this equation must hold. You know, if you are studying, say, atomic level phenomena, if you include the rotation of particles as a degree of freedom, which we did not include, our equations are based on the fact that each particle, based on the assumption that each point or each particle has 3 degrees of freedom, 3 translational degrees of freedom. If you include the rotational degrees of freedom, that means each particle has 6 degrees of freedom, 3 translational and 3 rotational, then no stress tensor is symmetric. Then we have to modify our framework. We have to restart the whole process. So we have to start from wherever we began on Monday. Whatever we covered till Monday, till last Friday was good. Fine, no change. However, whatever we started studying on Monday has to be redone if you want to include rotational degrees of freedom. And that is not called classical continuum mechanics. There is a mechanics theory, like theory of mechanics, that accounts for it. And I do know it, but I don't want to cover it because we have enough material, more than enough material, as far as classical continuum mechanics is concerned. And 99.9% of the time, I can even say 99.99% of the time, you deal with classical continuum mechanics. All the cars, planes, bridges we have been using are based on classical continuum mechanics. So it's fine, I mean, there is no problem. And most of the time, our experimental equipment is not sophisticated enough to find finer features of the deformation. So you cannot verify or experimentally validate if you refine the theory. I mean, if you cannot validate it, then you are not going to believe in it. Okay, so that's the problem. That is a problem. How to validate whatever we derive in our offices or whatever imaginary experiments we do. See, our imagination can take us anywhere. Like you dream. Yeah. It's good to dream. You should have a dream. Martin Luther King had a dream. Okay. So it's good to dream. Okay. However, for the dream to become reality, you need to have a physical experiment. And that is where the problems come. Okay. So we can include the rotational degrees of freedom, and then no stress tensor will be symmetric. Anything else you want to ask? And incidentally, don't forget to vote on next Tuesday. This is your chance. I'm not going to say for whom you vote, but you should vote. Okay, now, so what do we have? We have now six components of Cauchy stress tensor, Tj, because T is symmetric. So we don't have to worry about all nine components. We have six of them. Also, we have this equation, rho Ak equal to rho Bk plus delta Tkl over delta Xl. And this holds everywhere. This holds at every point in the body, at every point within the domain of the body. It holds at every point in the body. So who will tell me how many equations do we have now? Tim Hartman?
Three.
Very good. So we have three equations for k equal to 1, k equal to 2, and k equal to 3. So we have three equations of motion, one along x1 axis, one along x2 axis, or one along x, one along y, and one along z axis. So for k equal to 1, 2, and 3, so we have three equations of motion. Francis, are you happy?
Yes.
You didn't look like happy, but anyway. Oh, okay. So there are three equations. Now, whom should I ask? Oh, Carrie, in Wake Forest. How many unknowns do you see here? In this equation, mass density is known. If you know the material of the body, you know the mass density. Body force is gravity, which is known. So how many unknowns are there?
Three unknowns.
Which ones?
Acceleration.
Good. So those are three. Is anything else unknown? Well, that is right. Acceleration is not known. So there are at least three unknowns. But are there any more unknowns? Yes. There are no more unknowns?
The only thing left is going to be the Cauchy stress tensor, which we know it.
Which we know it? Yes. How do we know it? I did not give you any rule to find Cauchy stress tensor yet. Yes? I mean, you want to say something? Wake him up. He's awake.
You would only know it if you had, like, you did an experiment, you had strain gauges on something, and you guessed it, or, you know.
See, have we said anything about the material of the body yet? No. We have not said anything about the material of the body. These equations, as I said before, they are valid for every continuum. we have not related stresses to strains. Whatever we covered before Monday had nothing to do with forces. Whatever we have been covering since Monday, during the last four lectures, have nothing to do with motion, more or less. We did not say anything about strain rate today or strain or, right? Or since Monday, we have not talked about strain. The only thing we have been talking about is either velocity or acceleration. So there are nine unknowns. The unknowns at this stage of the game are displacements u1, u2, u3, or you can say velocities v1, v2, v3, or accelerations a1, a2, a3. And we have six components of unknown stresses, the Cauchy stress tensor. So we have nine unknowns. And we have three equations. So we cannot solve the problem yet. Generally speaking, the number of unknowns should equal the number of equations. Also, if we look at this equation, the equation we have, three equations we have, what do we see here? Delta Vi over delta T, time derivative. So even if I gave you six more equations, let's assume by some magic, then that is a magic, I gave you six equations, and we will study those, like how to get those six equations. What else do we need? Jessica, what else do we need? Supposing I have nine equations for nine unknowns. It's not compatibility. Will? Josh Strangler, not this Josh. Pierce wants to tell.
Are you talking about linear independence?
No. You should know it. You are in my finite element class. Yes, this Josh knows it. Boundary conditions. And initial conditions. Wherever you see time derivatives, you need initial conditions. So you need to know what was the initial state of the body, which means what is the initial velocity distribution. You need to know the initial velocity distribution where t time is zero here, so that thing should be given to us. And if you are doing a solid mechanics problem, in their velocity is time derivative of position or time derivative of displacement, in solids we find displacements. In fluids, we find velocities. So if you are finding displacements, then you have another time derivative here, because velocity is a time derivative of displacement. Then you need initial displacements also. So we need initial displacements and initial velocities. But if you are doing fluid mechanics, you want to find velocities, then you just need initial velocities. And if you are doing solid mechanics, then you need both initial displacements and initial velocities.
When we say initial conditions, right, is it in terms of the present configuration, the reference configuration or the present configuration?
Well, at this time, the way I'm writing it is in terms of the present configuration. But initially, if you start your clock at time zero and take that configuration as reference configuration, then you know things in the reference configuration. So it depends when you start your clock time t equal to zero. Okay, now the boundary conditions. I know all of you are looking at the clock. I know it's like 12:05. So you want me to quit? Okay, I will quit. Oh, please return the question papers.